I'm delighted to welcome Leah on back to Dawn Osborne in session. Lee, let everyone know how you are.
I'm well, you know, in spite of the fact that we are in lockdown here and there's a pandemic, I'm doing pretty good. Yeah. So I you know, it's that way in a lot of places. Toronto went into lockdown a few days ago, and Vancouver, where I am, is not very far behind. So yeah, you know, it's really hopeful that everyone's getting the vaccine and things are looking like, you know, concerts might be opening up within a year or so. But I think because that people are behaving a little more cavalierly, which is causing numbers to rise. I don't know what it's like in the UK right now, but in Canada, it's, yeah, our hospitals are getting overwhelmed. So anyway, but other than that, I'm doing great. And I've had lots of time to work on music. So that's been a great thing.
Yes, now you've got a new album, Radio On. Why is it called Radio On?
Well, to be honest with you, it's a little bit of an irony on how that title came about. We had written all the songs for the album, and the night before our last day in the studio, this is actually literally the week before Canada went into lockdown back in March of 2020, we had this idea kicking around, but we hadn't completed it. And I just got a flood of lyric ideas. I wrote when we finished this song the night before we went back into the studio for the last day. And it was the whole premise of the tune Radio On is I want to die with the radio on, because we're all dealing with mortality and aging and all that, these kind of life issues at this point in our life. It was supposed to be a song of hope about the fact that music is eternal. Music lives on, you know, so I want to die with the radio on. But having the word die in the title was a bit morbid. So we called it Radio On, the song, because it's about loving music, basically, is the premise of the tune. And also we went, because I mean, in Canada, I'm considered what is called, I guess they call it a heritage artist or a legendary artist, where, you know, if Bryan Adams can't get on the radio here, there's not much chance Lee Aaron will. So we thought it was ironic to call the album Radio On.
I think that this spirit of, you know, music being something that allows you to live in the moment, you know, was really shines through with that song. It's, you know, living in the now, which is what we're learning to do in the pandemic, I think.
Absolutely. Again, it's a song of hope and a song of living in the present and a song of living life to the fullest every day. Because, you know, I don't know if you've been feeling it the last few years, but I have been feeling health-wise, I feel fantastic. I think I feel like I'm in the best shape of my life because I've decided to really focus on wellness and eating well and taking care of my body. Because, you know, how as you start getting a little bit older, you realize if you use it or you lose it, right? But yeah, I mean, the last few years, you know, Prince, David Bowie, Lemmy, we've lost so many fabulous rock stars that, to me, in my mind, it's like you don't think of Bowie as an older, aging guy. I just always thought of him as a vibrant, current artist. And to lose him and Prince and all these people that are near and dear to my influences and my heart, I guess mortality has been on my mind, right? Mm-hmm. And so to write a song that sort of spins that into a positive message was something we were trying to do with Radio On.
Okay, and it's 12 original tracks. Is it true that you held your band hostage for 2 days in a room until they wrote the album with you?
Yes, it is, actually. This is the truth, okay? Like, my favorite albums of the past are those albums that have that, like the early Zeppelin albums, the early Who albums that have that kind of magical band energy. You know, the first Guns N' Roses record, you know, like the ones that just sound like, you know, we locked ourselves in our mom and dad's garage and we're just jamming tunes out that we think are just ripping and cool and that we think are going to impress our friends when they come over for beer and pizza and are going to listen, right? That's was so... I wanted to capture that energy. And all of us in the band are songwriters. Mm-hmm. I'm perhaps more the author in terms of lyric content and top line than anybody else is in the band, but everybody has great musical ideas. And because we are a band that is also, like, Sean Kelly's from Toronto, Dave Reimer, myself, and John live in the Vancouver area, but we don't, you know, Dave Reimer is on the island a lot with his partner, and he's not available to just sort of jump in for a rehearsal at any time. So we were doing a lot of writing by files previous to that. And there's, it isn't the same thing. So we had a show in Calgary, which is, you know, an hour away from Vancouver, Playground. And I said to Sean, bring your A game, bring your best ideas. I'm flying you to Vancouver after this show, and we are going to lock ourselves in our rehearsal space for a weekend, and we're gonna write some songs. I actually didn't think we'd write a whole album. I thought we would write a few songs, a few great songs toward the record. But previous to that, I had been on vacation, and we had gone on an all-inclusive because my children were bugging to go on an all-inclusive vacation. The truth be known, I'm sort of like a hummingbird. I always have to be busy, and I like all-inclusive vacations. I find them kind of boring. Like, I'm like sitting on the beach going, well, what do I do now? Scratching my head. So I brought my lyric book, and I just wrote poetry, and I wrote lyrics, and I wrote, you know, verses, and, you know, just snippets of ideas. And I did a lot of reading. And so I had come back with a book half full of ideas, and magically all of these ideas kind of, I went, you know, when Sean played me the intro riff to Russian Doll, I was like, oh, I think I have a lyric for that, right? And I went through my book, and by the end of it, we were like, holy crap, we have like 11, almost 12 songs here. And I think I'd like to think that the energy, that excitement and that energy translates onto the record. And, you know, even absolutely. The song, sorry, go ahead.
No, absolutely.
You know, a song like Vampin, which is the opening track, but there's a whole sort of, like, you know, vampy, no pun intended, vamping kind of section in the middle where we kind of go off on at a time and a tangent, and I'm just sort of singing some vocal scats, and we're like, this is the kind of music I want to write. I don't want to be confined into, you know, the 3.5 minute, you know, drums locked to a quantized grid kind of format. Because personally, I find a lot of that modern music, some of it's great, but a lot of it doesn't do anything for me because it doesn't sound human, right? Mm-hmm. They were really going for a human kind of feel on this album. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I think it follows on well from your last two albums because it's commercial hard rock, there's some pop, there's some blues, you know, but it's actually diverse, but with a strong heart of rock, I would say. Would you agree?
Well, yeah, I mean, and I have said this many times in the past, you know, some of my, like, top 10 albums, like top 10, top 20 albums that I would take to a desert island for the rest of my life are albums like that. Some of the early Elton John albums, like Fleetwood Mac Rumors. I know it's like one of the biggest and most popular albums in the world, but that album is very diverse. However, it still sounds like Fleetwood Mac, every single song. I would like to think that we have a sound, and I have a sound that is like that. Many of the Bowie albums ebb and flow and change with the times. He was always changing his sound, but he was still always uniquely Bowie. I would like to think that I'm an artist more like that. I'm always going to make rock records, but they're going to have flavors and they're going to have colors because the number one thing about me, I'm a music fan and I'm always listening to things. And I'm always absorbing things. And, you know, as long as I'm a music fan, those influences are going to creep into my music, right?
So. Mm-hmm. It's funny you mentioned Fleetwood Mac, because I've almost finished my review of the album for Fireworks magazine. And one of the things I said is my favorite is Soulbreaker. And it reminds me of Stevie Nicks a little bit, you know, not exactly the same, but reminds me, you know, the sort of beautiful harmonies and things in the voice. And also there's some 80s guitar in there as well. So yeah, that's my favorite.
Well, it's interesting because our radio tracker in Quebec just got back to us and said that Soulbreaker was her favorite. So yeah, there's a lot of... we've had a lot of different feedback. The label out of Germany, they love Come On and 21, the ballad. You know, my manager loves Vampin. He thought it should probably, you know, lead off the album and lead off as a first video single. And, you know, when you make a record where everyone likes a different song, I think that's a good thing.
Absolutely, that's right. And Mama Don't Remember as well. That's more 70s. That's kind of some glam rock influences, a bit of 12 bar blues in there, I think.
Yeah, little Mott the Hoople.
Yeah.
Funny because Dave Reimer, my bass player, brought in that idea. It was just a bass riff. As you hear the opener of that song, it's very dum da dum da dum da dum, right? And you know, and I wasn't sure I liked it at first because I'm like, geez, man, it's like so masculine. I don't know if it's too masculine for me, right? And and then we, you know, we had come up with this chorus, you know. Mama don't remember my name. And I'm like, okay, oh, this could be actually a cool road story. So that song is actually inspired by a true story that happened to me in, I guess, about 1998, 99. I was doing a big festival near Winnipeg called Minnedosa, Rock in the Fields of Minnedosa here in Canada. And I was sharing the stage that night with Jerry Lee Lewis and Joan Jett. And it was a great show. And as they had hired like the whole shebang, you know, fancy hotels, limousines. Then after the show, we were leaving and we get a limo with this guy who's driving. He's our limo driver. But he wants to party with the band. So he puts down the window and he's chatting us up. And anyway, he got lost. We didn't know where we were because we were rocking the fields. Like it's out in the boonies and it's about an hour away from our hotel, right? But it was a big enough site to hold the festival. He got lost in the middle of nowhere. We couldn't find a map. I opened the drawer underneath the seat. A bunch of pornographic magazines fell out. And then the guy starts, we wondered if the driver was actually drinking. He starts telling us that he used to be a radio host in Winnipeg, but he got fired because they thought he was doing hate speech. And I was just going, this is just like, it was like, this is rock and roll. You know, it was like one of the worst nights of my life. It took us about 2 hours to get to the hotel. I thought that we wondered if the driver was just some Lugan. And you know, the next morning I got up and the cover of the entertainment paper of the Winnipeg Sun was a picture of me in these slinky silver pants, which they were my stage clothes, but it was basically more a picture of my ass than anything else. And it said, so it wasn't a picture of Jerry Lee Lewis. It wasn't a picture of Joan Jett. It was a picture of me, you know, sort of turned around like, you know, this kind of cheeky kind of thing. It said, Lee Aaron gets cheeky. And it was very sexualized. And I was almost offended by it. And I thought, you know, is this what my 25 years in rock and roll has brought me to? Like this point? And I just, it was sort of, as much as we were enjoying sort of big festival success, it was kind of a low point for me personally, because I thought, you know, this rock and roll life is not what it's cracked up to be. Does that make sense? So that's kind of what that song is about. It was sort of about the shallowness of rock and roll and the fact that despite all the success, we still need true connections, right?
The title of the album, Radio On, that track, I think that could be a massive country hit. You know, I think that could go massive in Nashville. Did that occur to you?
No, not at all. In fact, when you said country, I was a little taken aback because for us, we thought it was more of a Rolling Stones-y kind of riff.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So we were kind of thinking like Stones-y rock and roll swagger in that tune.
Okay.
But I see how you might think it has a little bit of a country flavor because the Stones are very blues influenced, right?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it's Appalachian, isn't it? They took their stuff from America. So, yeah.
Yeah, you know, the kind of, you know, the bluesy swagger kind of riffs that Keith comes up with, right? And so I think that's what we were kind of going for.
Okay.
Again,
okay.
A lot of our influences you see here and feel on this album, right?
So, Soho Crawl, that's kind of down and dirty rock and roll. And I was wondering, is that about London or is it about the seedy side of life in general?
I was inspired to write. I had actually written a whole bunch of lyrics for that song before we even wrote the song. I had just finished reading Just Kids by Patti Smith. So it's all about that New York 1960s Andy Warhol studio, dirty New York vibe. That's what that song is about.
All right. Okay.
And it was very inspired, you know, like the Chelsea Hotel and the whole, you know.
Yeah.
That whole scene, you know, and how shortly after I read the book, I'm trying to remember the name of the movie, but it was a film about Edie Sedgwick, who was one of Andy Warhol's female proteges. And I'm digging a little deep here, right? But I'm kind of geeky that way. And so it was kind of, it was sort of about that dirty New York scene in the 60s.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
I mean, it still it applies to Soho in London, and of course we've got a Chelsea. So I wasn't sure, you know. So that's why I thought I'd ask. And Russian Doll, I just loved that. That's that quirky concept of a multi-layered personality in the song. And also that's got a fast rockabilly beat almost.
I think it's a little more like up-tempo Van Halen-ish kind of.
Okay.
It's kind of my kind of take on the tune. But yeah, well, it was, you know, the song was written during the craziness of the Trump administration. So, so it's, the song is supposed to touch on so many levels. It could be about a person with a multi-personality. Because Russian dolls, as you know, they are dolls that all fit inside each other.
Sure.
And I bought my daughter a set for Christmas when she was about 5 years old, and she loved them. She played with them for years. And so I had the idea of, you know, a Russian doll could be about a crazy girlfriend, but it could also be about American politics right now. So there's a lot of layers going on in that song, you know, because the second verse talks about, you know, the fact that she's with this guy, but, you know, I have lots of, you know, that I'm unpredictable, I'm volatile, I have many layers to my personality, but when you look at me, you see your own reflection, because you're the same way, right? So it's,
There's
psychological layers to my writing that a lot of people sometimes don't quite get, because it's all, you know, under the guise of the rock and roll umbrella, right? So a lot of times people don't dig too deeply into the lyrics, but yeah, these are the crazy things I'm thinking when I write songs.
Now, Wasted is quite an emotional song. It's tinged with sadness and anger, and there's some very poignant acoustic sections and some angrier electric sections. So that's a song, you know, that is quite, I would say, deep emotionally.
Yeah, that song is about growing up in a family with addiction. You know, I can say it's personal on many levels for me. I think the thing about that song is that many, many people in the world could relate to that topic, because no family is immune from mental health issues and addiction. You know, whether it's your immediate family or your extended family, people have, many, many people have situations like that where they find themselves in unhealthy, you know, family dynamics or relationships where, because what happens in an alcoholic or an addictive family is that there's a lot of shame. A lot of people don't want to talk about it. They hide those secrets. The whole family adjusts around the person's addiction to the point where they feel that it's normal, but it's not normal. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I know that Sean Kelly, my guitar player, his wife is a lovely lady. She's works for a big publisher here in Canada. She has an executive job there, and she's not really a rock fan. She is a music fan, but when she heard that song, Sean, he texted me. He said, "My wife just heard that song, and she started to cry." So yeah, I'd like to think that it touches people on hopefully many levels. My manager, when he heard it, when it was finished, he said, "Man," he said, "that song starts out so beautiful, and then it's like getting hit in the head with a 2x4." And I went, if I've accomplished that lyrically and emotionally, I think I've hopefully written a song that's accomplished what I was hoping to accomplish in that tune.
Sure, sure. And although the album does look at some of the darker sides of life, I think that actually overall your kick-ass spirit shines through, because I see you as somebody like that with a kick-ass spirit, and you know, also with your family and everything, you know, like sort of Mama the Rock, and you know, just you know, kind of just keeping everything, all the balls in the air. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, sometimes I feel like a crazy person some days because it gets a little complex. Like, you know, today I was fielding phone calls because just before this Zoom interview, because I'm getting a whole bunch of requests right now for interviews and my label has hired different partners in every territory, the UK, the Benelux, Germany, the United States. They've got two different promo firms. We've got two different people in Canada. So I'm kind of like, all these interviews coming. And then I just got found out today, unfortunately, because stores are in lockdown right now and every single vinyl plant is staffed by a skeleton staff because of COVID, they're going to have to push my release date they want to release CD and vinyl and everything on the same day. Mm-hmm. So my release date just got pushed back to July 23rd. I found out 5 minutes before I talked to you because of these things are impacting not just myself, but every single artist that's trying to put out summer releases right now. So yeah, July 23rd is the official date. Radio On is coming out, vinyl and otherwise. So yeah, I'm super excited. But yes, I like that you say I have a kick-ass spirit. I like to think I do. And even though, yes, we have explored darker themes on the album, there's a lot of hope. And even a song like Wasted, like you were talking, like it explores addiction, but it's almost like a pushback, like, you know what? This is finally the moment of reckoning and finally the moment of truth. And I'm not going to hide behind this any longer. That is what Wasted is about, right? And so that in itself is a message of power, I think.
Yeah, overcoming everything. And I think your albums, they always, your unique voice always manages to shine through. And I sometimes think that might be, you know, early on in your career, people tried to tell you what to do, you know, and I don't think that's a very good idea. Because I think, you know, you have got a unique voice and I think it does shine through and I think it's going to shine through.
Well, yeah. You know, the early few years of my career, I had a manager and I guess, you know, he thought he was doing what he thought was best. But his idea was to really push me into that, you know, market me as a poster girl, you know, sex kitten poster girl. And as I got older and more mature and started taking more charge of my career, I realized, you know, this is really uncomfortable. And, you know, it's one thing to project a healthy sexuality or to, you know, to be, you know, a glam mom, whatever, you know, everybody wants to be that. What's wrong with that?
A knockout, and you know? Still a knockout, I would say. I'm sure everyone would agree with me.
I like to think of it as a, you know, in a healthy way, you know, like I take care of myself and, you know, I take care of my craft and I take care of my home and my family and my children. And like these should be priorities for everybody, right? When you're home. So, growing up in the family that I grew up in, and this is actually a perfect segue. I'm writing a book right now.
Okay.
Should be coming out sometime within the next year. I'm deep into my fourth chapter right now, about my life and about my childhood and how all of those things helped to inform who I became as a person and as an artist, right? And growing up in the family that I grew up in, you know, I didn't have a lot of self-confidence when I was young, and I questioned what was normal a lot of the times. And I think those were just all powerful factors which allowed me to be kind of manipulated in the early stages of my career. So I'm not really casting blame, a blanket of blame onto anybody, but, you know, this is my story. And but I'm not in that place anymore. Now I wear hats, you know, mom, you know, songwriter, producer. I've produced my last six albums.
Absolutely.
A lot of people aren't aware of that, right? So, it's life is good.
Yeah. Kick ass.
Awesome.
Kick ass. Absolutely. Will you be touring to support the record, Lee? And do you think you're going to make it to the UK when traveling is allowed? I mean, I know things have just taken a bit of a dive in Canada, you know, but when it is allowed.
Well, absolutely. I would love to get to the UK. One of my goals at this age and stage of my life is that I'm all down for doing dates, but the band and I, we're not into we are family people. We can't come over to, you know, Europe and stay for 8 weeks and tour a bunch of little venues. So our thing is, you know, our modus operandi these days is, you know, get a big festival date as an anchor and then add on some dates around that in specific territories. So I would love to play a big festival in England. That's like, it's been my goal for the last couple of years. We just, there's a lot of factors, you know, extraneous factors that determined coming over for doing something like that, you know, popularity, having an agent that's gunning for you, because there's so much competition to get on those big festivals, right? You know, where do you fit? You know, is it the right format? How much money can they offer you depending on which stage you're going to play? Is that enough money to fly my whole band over there and make it work, right? So yeah, we would love to play a festival in England and then tag on some shows in various places.
And given lockdown where you are at the moment, what's next for you? You're writing your book. I think I heard that you're writing for another new album. And if that's true, what can you tell us?
Yeah, we've got six songs in the bag already for the new album. So I know it's crazy because we're probably going to start recording for another studio album right around the time that Radio On comes out. You know, we're probably going to be recording in July or August of this year. We started writing because we all have world-class home studios and we can. So with that said, we're not going to record just remotely. Our goal is that if things loosen up a bit by the summer, we'd like to go into put a block of studio time into our summer, probably in August. And we're planning to go in with Mike Fraser. Mike Fraser, who recently just mixed the AC/DC record that came out, we're up. You know, he's done Van Halen, he's done Metallica, he's done all kinds of amazing bands. He's just one of my favorite people. He's, you know, he's a wonderful person, one of my favorite humans, and he's just an amazingly talented guy. So we're really excited. We're going to go in and record bed tracks with him, and he's going to probably be mixing the new record as well. So,
okay, that's fabulous. All right, yeah. Everything going on. Thank you so much for making some time to talk to us, Lee. Great to see you looking so well. You're looking fantastic. And,
thank
you know, having the credibility as well. You know, I know that you don't like sort of to be all about the image, but when you're as fantastic looking, it's definitely going to grab the front page just like you did. But, you know, also, I think, you know, you continue, particularly in the UK, to get the respect, you know, of the songwriter and producer you are. And it's lovely to see.
You're awesome, Dawn. Thank you so much. You always ask great questions, and it's a pleasure to talk to you.
Hopefully see you soon when you come over. Maybe awesome. Later in the year or next year. I really hope that happens.
Well, as soon as it's safe to get on a plane, we're coming. That I can tell you. Awesome. Take care, Dawn.
Thanks so much. All right.
Bye.